and to catch it on the cable news and so forth. And here it comes to our example about language. If you go and look at CNN or any of these headline news or stuff, you'll see that they keep saying words that bring up hurricane. And they'll make a statement like, we haven't seen flooding like this since Hurricane Frank or whoever. And then they'll say, boy, this the amount of flooding here at this level hasn't been seen since Hurricane Ira, and so on and so on. So we actually got the language correct. There was a, quote, surprise hurricane. It just didn't have any winds with it. But we're having all the other effects that were described within that immediacy data, including the fact that they have to rescue people, and there's a minor level of evacuations going on, and there is some damage, and that there will continue to be damage, and it'll continue around for a couple of weeks as the effects of this are all told. So the language is actually showing up, even though the linguistics at the time led me to think it would actually be a hurricane, not a many references to a hurricane without winds, if that makes sense.
It does. Well, we had a surprise tornado here.
Yes, but that doesn't count.
Two of them, I think.
Yeah, there's a slightly different critter there, yeah. But the interesting part of all of that is that the immediacy data, where we have our actually have the most spectacular level of striking examples of being accurate, is within the immediacy data. But it, and you would think that, oh, well, we'd just drop all this shorter-term stuff and crank out reports once a month or something using just the immediacy data. The problem is, with the immediacy data, that we always feel that we're chasing time because there's so much of it, it might take us 2 months to digest, and by that time, half of all of those predictions have already happened. Or half of the forecasts that we could have made have already occurred and the events are out. Just because there's so much of it and it's tedious to go through. In fact, these newer reports, we're actually using mostly short-term and long-term data to try and get ahead of it without this continuous chasing time feel. I mean, you think about deadlines. Here we've got deadlines within the language itself, not necessarily artificially imposed, but you certainly feel that way. And so it's driving us crazy. It's much more relaxed now to do it this way, but we do miss that level of striking examples of being correct. Like the power, Northeast power outage of a number of years back was one of our better forecasts, and it came out 3 weeks before the event, was just surprisingly accurate in the linguistics. And that was because it came from the immediacy data, where we have that rich layer of detail involved. But that's kind of, you know, it's a difficult process no matter what. So really the path we're on at the moment makes a lot more sense because we need that longer-term heads-up in order to do anything.
That makes absolute sense, but it's just, apart from from the knowledge and the information that you put out, it's each time that you talk, it reveals to me, it makes clearer to me, not how you're doing it, but what you're doing, mm-hmm. and it is absolutely fabulous.
Fascinating.
Well, it's a ton of work.
Yeah,
when we got into the immediacy data there, and especially now that, and there's another aspect of this that's curious. Over the past, I don't know, 7 years or so, the level of immediacy data relative to the other data types has significantly grown, even though a number of our sources for data have been cut off by, for instance, we can't access China anymore. It used to be we were getting all kinds of stuff out of China, but the Chinese government's getting really tight on clamping stuff down. So even though we've lost some sources, we still find immediacy data is going way up. Now, if one had a large enough history, then one might be able to say, maybe people are becoming more psychic and something is actually occurring relative to our environment, and that's why we're seeing this growth of immediacy data. Curious thought, eh?
Yes, that's a very lovely thought. Maybe people are paying more attention to themselves.
I was thinking the other way, though. I was thinking that even if they weren't paying attention, maybe this new area of space, the extra energies that are coming in, are actually impacting humans, and that's why we're seeing more and more leaks of immediacy data and thus the growth of it. Just as real curious, we're in 97 or 98, I established a baseline for a particular run I was doing, and it was relative to the amount of UFO information that was out on the net. And so I got this baseline, and that baseline between late 98, so probably October of 98, and the first part of 2000, oh, maybe June or so of 2000, there was a 10,000% increase. And then from 2000 to 2003, there was a tenfold increase off of that. And then we've seen a continued rate of growth since then relative to language associated, and it eventually fell all into our entity where we have the unknown and officially denied and denied the science and all of this kind of stuff all stored together because we had to have some bucket for it all. And that's our Space Goat Farts entity. And it has grown substantially. It used to be relatively small, and now, and it was not an artifact of our processing.
Well, so let's let people go. New listeners, halfpasthuman.com, and that's where you can order the reports that we've been talking about. And here we are with Cliff, Beyond the Ordinary. We'll be back.
Ah, Beyond the Ordinary, Cliff is with us today, halfpasthuman.com. So what's next, Cliff?
Well, there's this issue of the meme that we've seen out there, the 15% business. People that have read the most recent report, I go to, there's a few paragraphs, three or four paragraphs, discussing this idea of 15%. And we saw it out there sometime back. We didn't know what the detail was going to be, but we knew that there was going to be a new wedge. The thin edge of a wedge was going to make its appearance, and this wedge was going to be a propagandistic tool for the powers that be, which will surface probably about July of next year and then take a whole 3 or 4 months of real intense force behind it before it fades. But basically the idea is this. You're going to encounter the idea that someone is out there with, presumably with the cast of authority behind them, suggesting that some 15% of the populace of Earth, of humans, has alien DNA in them. And this is apparently spread across all what we think of as all races of humans. I think there's only one human race, and there's just subdivisions within that. So I get into trouble talking about this kind of thing. So, but across all of the subdivisions of humans, you know, Caucasoid, Negroid, Mongoloid, et cetera, there's some 15% of each of these people presumably have this alien DNA in them. Now, this is really a curious kind of a thing because this is probably factual, but it doesn't matter that it's factual if it is. And the reason that it doesn't matter is because the powers that be are going to use this 15% idea to try and recruit those 15% or the people that believe that they're in that group on their side. And it'll come at a crucial point in the revolutionary process where the powers that be will be ultimately revealed, and they'll say to these 15%, look, you're special. You've got 15% of your DNA is alien DNA. Now you need to align with us because we also have alien DNA. Of course, we have more, so we're higher up and you've got to pay attention to us. But nonetheless, you're more like us than you are like them. And so this divisive wedge is another one of those divide and rule, or, you know, divine right of kings kind of things that's being upgraded to this new century. And the idea will be that, well, kings don't have a divine right to rule, but kings have a ET right to rule, so to speak, because they're blessed, I guess, is how the term would be, with a greater level of alien DNA. And so it would just rack out into, again, to a hierarchical society where there's a very elegant few at the top, the 15% below them who are going to be their new level of minions, and then the 85% of just regular humans. And there's going to be, linguistically, their forecast now, that they're going to attempt to use this to get people within the 15% group to go along with the idea of being brutal to the humans, because after all, they're primitives, you know, just on the par of higher order primates, and that's about it. And this is really a disturbing meme on one level, because it doesn't bode well. It'll come out during the repression and the suppression of the enlightening phase here over this next 6 months, 8 months. But at the same time, it's also very heartening because it's about as a naked a manipulation technique as there can be, and the fact that they have to resort to this level of stuff means they're getting very close to that resource constraint whereby they'll start to fail. Make sense?
Oh, that's the important part right there. That is very good, because it is a very trite method, since it's been used so much throughout history. And that's good if people hear it.
Sure, once you're exposed to the idea, then you're free of it.
Yes. So that's good, because, you know, it's always that that enticement of, oh, I'm special.
Sure, the separation, exactly.
Yes.
And what we really need now is we've got to consider a bunch of different things now, actually, as humans. And one of the things I like thinking is that, well, you just don't get any more, old, raspy, and bald, and ugly as me. So I'm pretty much, I'm in that 85% group. And I want to be in that 85% group because humanity as a whole is obviously favored by universe. Otherwise, we wouldn't have lasted this long. But obviously, or not obvious, perhaps, to some people, but let me say rather that I have a conclusion that this interesting area of space that we're in has yet to get to its peak of interesting and strangeness, and that when we do, perhaps all kinds of really strange stuff will be revealed. Now, I think that this is part of the process of humans going from the class zero civilization to the class one civilization. And class one is to take it from being planetary and destroying the planet to survive to being planetary and harmonious, zero point energy, repairing the environment, this sort of thing, and also beginning to be extraplanetary in a sustainable way. And so class civilization, class one or type one civilization is kind of like Star Trek. You don't necessarily need money and everybody gets together and they all decide, okay, let's build ourselves a big boat and go cruise around in space and have fun. And other people decide that, well, they're going to clean up the oceans and, reset this particular component of the habitat here or go and explore Mars or this kind of thing. So it'll be a really fun time. The problem is, and perhaps this is just part of the way that universe is structured, is that there's these idiots in the form of the powers that be that stand between us and this class one, or between us and the step into class one. And the step into class one is going to be horrific. We've got a lot of work to do. Most of the planet is not yet ready, but apparently there are enough that we're starting to see some of this stuff come out. So I'm rather hopeful that also along the idea of the 2013-2014 period of time, we may actually be seeing our first cohesive thoughts and planetary work into going into class or type one civilization. And it means that we've got to get rid of a lot of stuff, though. In the process, we've got to shed the idea of monarchies, we've got to shed the idea of specialness, we've got to shed the idea of any sort of religious hierarchy. We can keep religion, that's fine. I don't want to get people pissed off at me, but I'm saying that as long as everybody's out there worshiping the Pope, you are not ready to be a type one civilization. As long as you're allowing an imam to tell you to be a suicide bomber, you're not ready for a type one civilization. And as long as you're in a secret society worshiping a goat and perverting justice through suborning the courts and the political process,